So, I'm here that would like to speak if you want to introduce yourself. Anybody here? Okay, great. Start with an approval of minutes.
So moved.
Thank you. Second?
Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any extensions? Sort of an approval, Mark, abstaining?
No, I second.
No, me.
Mark Stevens?
Sorry, Mark.
You guys can't sit next to each other.
Right.
Okay, so the minutes are approved. In the closed session, we have a closed session actually earlier just for, to accommodate our guests today. And we have actually gotten to report that we're coming time, so we are going to go on and move on to the treasurer's report.
So, if you can pull out your packet, there's two sets of financials because we had to review our December closeout. So that's the first one I'm going to go with, and that's the one that it has a balance sheet of the, as of December 31st, 2013. Not too much has changed here from last month, except we did have some recasting and reclassifications of some of our coding of our expenses that were miscoded this year and just changed back to those categories that they should have been in originally. Two footnotes that we wanted to point out. One is number one, just under cash for HEDO 918, there's a $2,000 and some change, and that just goes back to, we got some checks from the International Downtown Association that were voided in December, and so this is a credit that we'll be getting for that. The other, and this is actually an error, and unfortunately Gersey was not able to get us the revised statements before this meeting, but under number two, we had a, Lauren and I spent a great amount of time going through each of our accounts. It was one of just probably the best thing she's ever done in this job. And we spent like a half a day going through. One of the things that we noticed was that we had mistakenly double paid an invoice to Andrews. And so there's a $15,412, not $912, a $412 credit that we will be receiving from Andrews too, and that will actually bring us under budget. We'll actually pretty much in line with our budget for a security contract last year. This, our statements last month showed that we had actually gone over budget in our security contract, which was not the case. Steve has done a really great job of bringing us in within budget this year. So those are some things just to note on the balance sheet.
And Joe, is that going to come in as a refund, or is it going to be just a credit?
We're actually working that out right now with Andrews. It looks like it's probably a credit towards a future invoice for all of it. The next page just shows us cash on hand at the end of the year. Something that is a little bit misleading is that it looks like we had $640,000 to end the year for HEDO 918, which is our main account. That's all the assessment monies that we collect. But you have to remember that we also had the accounts payable that were due and the liabilities. So if you deduct that, that's it's actually around $372,000 that we ended the year with last year. The good news is, and I'll go into depth on that in a minute here in January, but we were able to receive some past due assessments, as typically is the case at the end of the year, so that'll bump us up a little bit. Age receivables as of December, you can see that we had about $280,000 just outstanding going back to 2009, the beginning of the bid. Income statement by department, this just shows you pretty much a breakdown of income that came in for the month of December. Nothing new really to report there, other than, like I said, the security contract had changed from last month because there was that credit that is due, so that went down. We had our maintenance contract is now $73,200. If you have an item detail, that was actually $770, I think, last month, or $750 last month. And the reason for that was, again, one of those miscoding. We had our computer, somehow our computer consultant ended up in there, so that's been corrected. That's pretty much it for that. One last thing on that. Go to the second page under contingency. You'll also notice that now we're showing that we have negative 4,890 contingency. And the reason for that is we have been using that account for our office move and expenses associated with that. Those things have now been capitalized and they'll be depreciated. And so our accountants have gone through and looked at those expenses and taken them out and now put them in capitalization. budget variance, this just shows you our budget variance for the year, categories, how we finished the year. I'm not gonna spend too much time on this, so that's that. And since we're running out of time, you can go through the consolidated, that just shows for both. That shows you what our expenses were, actual versus budget for Hollywood and the central position. So that's December. No, that's already taken into account. He put it there and there. Yeah, it's, I know that, I was just talking to them about that. It's happening. I know. That's, yeah, they gotta revise that.
Yeah.
Moving on to January. So this is just to show you. So if you're looking at the cash on hand, you might start to get a little worried because it's about 160,000 difference there from some expenses that we had to pay out, is like I said, liabilities that we had for last month. The good news is that this does not show, because it's only through January 31st that we had our first installment of assessment funds received, about $1.2 million that came in on February 6th, I believe. So that will show up on your next statements for next month. But we have money in the bank, we're continuing operations right now. The other thing that I wanted to note, like I said, was the age receivables. So look at that page for a second. I want to spend just a few minutes on this because it's important. You'll notice, like I said, we had about $280,000 outstanding in December 31st. Now we're down to about $140,000 outstanding. We did collect about $115,000. The difference, the actual difference, is $139,000. But $115,000 of that was collected at the end of the year, and that came from previous year's assessments. I'm going through right now, line by line, and trying to figure out the parcel breakdown of what that was. Around 63,000 of that was from Metro Parcel. Some of it was from private other owners in the area, and I'll have a better description of what that was probably at the next meeting. There is a difference of about $24,000 in there, though, and what I went through and saw was that actually they have put into this deduction 2015-2016 numbers from this current year. So that should not have gone towards paying down age receivables. So they need to correct that. We actually, so the actual number of outstanding collectibles is more around $163,000 that we have outstanding. So.
Joe, is that gonna affect the 2015 balance sheet?
It will slightly affect the because we'll have some additional, revenue there for that. So that is, it should, I think, impact it. It's a good question. I didn't take a good look at that, but yes, ideally, I think it would, yes. The other thing to note is that when we submitted our planning report to the city of LA, we have built this budget. It's predicated on a $200,000 rollover, of which we had thought about maybe we would end the year with around 565.40, I think. We came in under that, but with these extra monies coming in, we should be right on par with what we anticipated. So as long as we keep our budget within line this year, we should be fine. So that's important. So we'll be sure to watch the budget extra close this year.
So just a quick question. Halfway down, there's a receivable. It looks like they've paid in full 2014-2015, but then they didn't 2013-2012. They paid in 2011.
Right. So I have that exact one under one.
Okay.
I mean, that's the Metro. And so what happened with that is there's a whole issue.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah. So income statement by department, just everything here is pretty much just showing you from the beginning of the year where we're at. Nothing too crazy to point out other than our accounting fees are still coming in kind of high. And we had a meeting with Gersey, who is our new accountant. Mark was there. And thank you, Mark, for being there. Just to kind of get a sense of what we're doing. We're going to do some new things to try to bring down the hours and the time that we're using them. So that's, it's going to be a little bit of a challenge, like, because we do rely on our accountants for certain things, but we're going to try to find a new system to keep that in line, because right now it's above what we have budgeted. And especially last year, we spent a lot of money on accounting, which we had anticipated knowing that we were switching that.
Yes, it is a discount for, I believe, the January bill, and which we just paid, I think, because we've had a complete staff change over there. She can give us a discount on it.
So that's that. And then consolidated budget variance, again, for the sake of time, you can leave that and ask me if there's any questions, if there's nothing in there, other than just the usual things. And again, we'll see next week that the actual the income is going to be higher. And this is actually where you will see it, Mark, is here. It only shows the 580.46, which from the what we invoiced the city, that was penalty income. But it should actually be like 29,000 something, because that 24,000 is going to go there. That would be part of this. So that was received back in January. So that's where you'll see that 24,000 in the consolidated budget.
And we just got these late last night, and I've been on all day of meetings, so I haven't really had a chance to look at these yet. And so I think our practice is to give the finance committee, which would be Mark and David and now Frank and Monica, the full packet. And then perhaps we can schedule a conference call even next week if you have any questions. We're still trying to finesse these reports, which are
Are
there any questions on the financials?
So are we going to table approving them until?
I think you could approve the December one, because we are in November, but I actually would like to take a look at January. So maybe you could table January until February.
That's fine. Okay, so approval, do you have a motion to table as of December 31st, 2015 financial statements?
Motion.
Thank you, David. All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And any abstentions? Thank you, Joe, for doing that. Do business.
Yeah, so I'm sure that you've already heard about the Neighborhood Integrity Initiative, which is a measure that's being proposed for the November ballot. We have just been kind of keeping our fingers on the pulse of what that looks like, and there's been different groups that have been forming. The LA Chamber has a group that is, it's got everybody from affordable housing developers to labor to anybody in, anywhere in between who has an interest in Los Angeles. And so we've been approached by them to have our organization support the effort to fight this initiative. This motion is simply just asking for us as an organization to engage in those efforts and just lend our name to supporting it. And so there's a lot of speculation right now as to what will happen in November. We're still in the process of getting signatures to put this on the ballot. Just today at 8 o'clock this morning, there was a countermeasure initiative that was proposed and put forward by labor and some of the affordable housing developers in the community that took a very different stance from the Neighborhood Integrity Initiative. I actually got the formal language for it today, just before this meeting, and I apologize, I haven't had the chance to fully read through it, but I will, and I'll give a report as to like what the impacts would be from that initiative at the next meeting. But this motion just relates solely to the Neighborhood Integrity Initiative, and if whether or not we want to take a position on that.
So basically, we'd be adding our name to a coalition that is growing, and this is under the leadership of the LA Chamber of Commerce, and adding Hollywood Property Owners Alliance to the list of organizations who are in favor of the Coalition for Jobs and Housing, which is obviously going to work to oppose the Neighborhood Integrity Initiative. Central Hollywood Coalition Board voted last year to add their name to that. So that is the motion. If you are so inclined, and if not,
any discussion on it, or people not familiar with what this is? We had a discussion about it last meeting.
Yeah, I think it's a great idea. I mean, it's the initiative is a job killing, housing killing effort, and I think it's something that we're always careful about. Not to get involved in the majority of these legislative items, but this is something that I think all of our stakeholders would support, at least lending our name to their effort to fight this stuff. So I'll make the motion.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Add our name to that list.
And I will point out that next, I think it's Tuesday night, 23rd, the Studio District Neighborhood Council is holding a kind of a forum or a quasi-debate on this measure. LaRon is going to be a speaker, and Alyssa is actually going to be a speaker representing another coalition that has been formed. I was at the Chamber Board meeting last night, and it was suggested that as many community members come out to be in attendance at Emerson College to show that, you know, the Hollywood community is definitely opposed to this neighborhood integrity initiative.
6 p.m.?
I think it's
5:30.
We'll get to that in a check, yeah.
It's at Emerson College.
Okay, committee reports, nominating committee. Would you like to report?
Well, we have one board opening, so I think, you know, the committee is requesting proposed new board member to fill that role. So if anyone has any suggestions, get that to any of us, to John, myself, or Greg Beck. We would appreciate it. We have, I think, one person so far whose name is going into the ring, so to speak. And so we would, you know, look to expand it for consideration.
What's the timeline level? Is it?
I don't know that we have, but we have had a chance to discuss it. I don't know what the timing is. But the
Sooner the better. The position's open.
Yeah, so they will be filling the vacancy created by Jan's departure. And Jan is sending in the name of one of the executives for the consideration of the nominating committee. But so this would be a good time, if you have any other suggestions on people who should be considered the board, to let Michael know.
Thank you.
Sure, so I'm just going to give a quick update on one of our pilot projects that we installed about 2 weeks ago. So this is the pilot planter project. You may recall we approved the purchase of four planters to try out. Just a reminder on the location here at Hollywood and Vine, there's a planter on each corner. Just some photos of the install and the types of plants we've used. And this is the final product. So I think it turned out nicely. Unfortunately, some plants have already been ripped out. It's been 2 weeks, but we're confident we can find the right selection of plants that will be a little bit more durable and maybe not as enticing to pull out. So there's the update on that.
And,
yeah.
So tomorrow we have our first streetscape committee, and we will talk about the
final. They were stolen?
I don't know if they were stolen or just thrown away, but they were ripped out.
Like poison ivy.
Yeah, with thorns, yeah. So we will be bringing this up to the streetscape committee to see if they like the result and if we want to pursue more planters for the Boulevard.
Do they have any problem with people throwing trash or rash tray?
Not so far, not that I've seen. I walk by it every day, and for the most part, I think it was the long holiday weekend that the plants got cooled out, but besides that, no other problems.
Yeah, that's
good. Okay, and then I think we're going to talk about our maintenance contract.
Yeah, so just two things. One is that we were unable to get, we're having a change order to the contract. We can actually explain in a moment. Just in terms of, we have Queen Street doing some watering of the new trees that we planted, and so we missed putting that on the agenda, but we will put that in March for approval of the board to do a change order to that. And then the other is that we have Matthew, in his due diligence and doing a great job in his role, has really done a great job of kind of being out on Queen Street, making sure that they're holding up to everything that we've been asking them to, and we've been noticing there's been a little bit of slippage in certain areas. So we just want to put the board on notice that we're going to be probably conducting an audit. We're right now developing the criteria of what that would be. And it will be probably a 30-day audit that we will do sometime in the next month or so, to just kind of see where those gaps are and how we can help, or how they can help pretty much fill them, or, you know, if we need to take further measures for that. But we just want to let everybody know that we're in the process of doing that. So.
Yeah, and then also for the year, the committee will be looking at some potential new software that we can implement, just to kind of help us keep track of all of the going ons out there, and kind of helping Queen Street make sure that they're being compliant in their contract. So we'll be working on that this year as well. The change order in here, again, we're not seeking a motion to approve this yet, but you'll see in the redlined version, we're just expanding on the contract to include the new planters, watering the new planters, as well as some new trees that we planted. So those are the changes on the third page.
What's the change order on that?
There's no change, and it's just that it changes the responsibilities, yeah. So if you have any questions or comments, you can let me know about that. And then just a note on here that we will be training our security team on the 25th. This is the item we brought to the board last month about the illegal dumping investigation. So we'll be training them on the 25th. It's a 2-hour session. Investigator Aaron Harris from BSS is going to be conducting that training. And then the last item is we have our first streetscape and planning committee meeting tomorrow morning here at the office at 9:30.
And you, the committee members, they all know who they are?
Yes, they all have the invitations, yes.
Thank you so much.
9:30, yeah.
Devin?
Sure. We have started to talk to Haynes & Co. about our project for 2016. So I want to just quickly run through some of the ideas that we've been talking to with them. First is the spotlight on historic theaters here in Hollywood. You probably all heard about the huge Night on Broadway event downtown. We'd like to shine the spotlight here on Hollywood that we do have a lot of historic theaters here also. So the first step would be getting together with the actual theater owners to kind of see what form that would take. Possibly it would be a tour with the publication or maybe multiple writers, but just some way to celebrate all the historic theaters that we have here. There's also several new restaurants that have opened or will be opening soon, so we want to highlight them in another foodie blogger tour. Those are always really popular. The writers love those and they share a lot of positive messages about Hollywood through those. We want to have desk side briefings with a few publications that we've selected, Curbed LA, LAist, and Urbanized LA. They're helping us to develop the points that we'd like to share with those organizations, just so that we can be a source of information for them in the future. We do have the storefront activation here, which is underway. You can already see the different colored blooms that we have in the window and the decals and the sign is already up. We had a meeting here last week, which I invited all the board members from both boards to attend. We have some ideas now that we got from Claire at Haynes & Co. of how we can activate those windows in a really cost-effective way that we can also change frequently. So that consists of doing somewhat of a neutral background, so not really a mural, more of just like a background, and then utilizing cardboard boxes that are different colors, stacked, kind of mimicking like a skyline. And then those boxes could include messaging or renderings or photos or even 3D models placed on top of the boxes. So it's something that we could change out whenever the need would arise to change them out. So we'll continue to develop that with her and we'll bring you back something probably next month of how it would actually look.
And we also have started to not put the roll down door down.
Yes.
So we are keeping the lights on and so far so good.
Speaking to the motion that you just recently passed about joining the Coalition for Jobs and Housing, Haynes & Co. is aware of this, and now that you've made that motion, they will help us prepare any statements or any information that we as an organization want to represent us in this broader coalition. And then lastly, the Holy and Hollywood Music and Arts Festival. I guess we'll move right on to the action for the item for this. We did have a meeting this week on Tuesday where we invited all the partners and several board members, Leslie and Michael were both there. And we had some board members from Sunset too. So we have tentatively set the dates of October 6th through 8th, just so that we have dates set aside where there's no other conflict at that time. The exciting thing is we've been talking to some bigger players that would like to get involved this year. We do have a meeting coming up, I think, in March with Jimmy Kimmel Live. Capitol Records was at the meeting, and they expressed that they are already planning a 75th anniversary event in October and discussed the potential to align that with the Only in Hollywood Festival. And similarly, Palladium Live Nation was in the room, and so there could be some way that we could work with them on an event during that time. They don't have anything booked during those dates at this moment. And Dream Hotel is also looking at doing an opening event on Selma between Cahuenga and Wilcox, which would also hopefully be around the same time. They were looking a little earlier, but we're trying to convince them to align it with these dates. And you know, they're still under construction, so it remains to be seen if they would even be ready by their date. So with that in mind, the committee is very excited about all these possibilities. We've really gotten a jump on getting sponsorships. We've contacted a lot of different companies. We've been having a lot of different meetings and phone calls. And then Carrie and I went through the marketing budget just to make sure that, you know, if we do allocate money for this, we're not going to be taking things away from our other initiatives. So I went through the budget, and we can still do everything that we normally do, all of our newsletters, our website, social media, the various events that we are part of, like the Hollywood Expo and the Economic Summit. And with all that combined right now, we would still have about $10,000 left in the marketing budget in case anything else came up. So I'm fairly confident that if we did allocate the $25,000 for the festival, we would still be able to effectively do all of our other marketing activities.
So does that mean $25,000 would be the absolute cap on what the property owners would spend on it?
Well, I think for right now, it would be. We're also asking the Sunset Bid to allocate an amount of money, because last year a lot of the venues and the activity did take place in the Sunset Bid. And then we are really increasing the amount of sponsorships that we're looking for this year too. So that wouldn't be the whole event budget, but it would be the budget that HPOA is contributing towards the overall budget.
From marketing, because we also would take some money out of temporary health and insurance to pay for the event. Insurance would be separate, and temporary health to help us with the staffing. That the overall budget, which you saw at the meeting earlier this week,
You need sponsorship.
Yeah, would expand based on sponsorship. Exactly. Right.
So we have to get the sponsors as early as possible.
As early as possible. All right. So we're going to move forward with this, and you know what the budget is, and where the time is, and we discussed this the last time.
Yeah.
Well, this is what we wanted to bring this to the board to authorize us moving forward. We did have the meeting this week with the broader committee who said we were bringing in here that we would like to bring in about, you know, $40,000 and $50,000 in external sponsorships to help, you know, make it there to have a sponsored stage. To actually, we have reached out to the owner of the parking lot behind Urban Outfitters as a potential location to buy out that parking lot and to have a sponsored stage there, or a small street club on Ibar or Selma in order to expand the music options. But that, of course, would take sponsorship dollars. So I think that with our subcommittee, you know, guiding us, the $25,000 would be the limit we would spend out of our marketing activities, but I think that's all we would have.
And your overall budget would be subject to how much
sponsorship.
Yeah, so this is money that we spend on.
Yeah, although it will be spent over, you know, over time.
And what did we spend last year? It was similar, right?
We spent $23,000.
Yeah.
And we spent about $5,500 in temporary help and about $1,100 in insurance costs. And we raised about, $20,000 in sponsorship. Crescent Heights, Sunset, and
I mean, the challenge we have and continue to have is chicken and the egg. You know, in order to attract artists and turn into a festival, you need the sponsorship so that the resources are there. So, you know, so we'll see what happens. Hopefully, Capitol 75th anniversary could be an incredible good luck for us and a wonderful coincidence. And really, you know, their celebration was there, definitely planning. They're going to do something really unique. It only happened in Hollywood, and that's really something, we can piggyback on that. It could put us in the game in a way that I don't know would happen otherwise.
It could be a, it could be an opening, it could be a closing, and so Capital wasn't our meeting, and we asked, would you be willing to, you know, be in some way linked with us to at least acknowledge that we would then happen maybe immediately thereafter or what have you, but, you know, Maureen is very open to that. So it is like moving a lot of pawns across the chessboard, you know, we're just, and we are meeting with Jimmy Kimmel's folks next week.
Yeah, I mean, they're good neighbors, they want to be helpful, absolutely, they just can't force their artists to make them helpful. So that's really up to us to make it happen, and the time will tell whether we can do that.
What are they thinking if they were still in the celebration?
It's in October, we don't have an exact date.
So that's about the time frame that we find out.
Yep, yep.
Is any other discussion or motion for the $25,000? Other discussion, does anyone want to make a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
On paper?
Aye.
Any opposed? Any extensions? So everyone get going on that. Window application.
Oh, I kind of covered that. We had the meeting, and we are working with Claire to kind of actually sketch out a little bit.
And then one question about the theater tour, is that envisioned for bloggers or for newspapers or for the public?
I think the way Narisa was thinking, like, it might be best to offer it as an exclusive to one publication if we got a really good publication interested in it, start from there.
But we also, we thought we should bring all the theater owners into the room,
yeah,
including theaters that are closed,
mm-hmm,
so that it's a, we've got all those property owners in the room to talk about how do we tell the story about our historic theaters.
Yeah.
So we want to engage, you know, from the ex-theater on down, we've got, you know, seriously, I mean, because either we include them or not, but we want to get input on the best way to tell the story. So.
If the Egyptian was in the LA Times today.
It was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Good article.
So that's not going to happen quickly, but we're going to start to support them.
Great. John, do you have any other questions?
Sure. We did not have our security committee meeting this month. We just didn't have enough security committee members that were able to make it. The majority of our security actions were spending time reviewing LAPD's request to put out a security force in the nighttime hours. That work consisted with just meeting with several key stakeholders. We've been around a bit for a long period of time, getting their thoughts about the benefits of putting some nighttime security out there in lieu of daytime deployment. Speaking with staff about the issue, speaking with Andrews about the issue. The general consensus was that the daytime deployment was critical, and that we wanted to do, that's number one. Number two is we want to do everything we can to accommodate Captain Zarcone's request. So the other thing we did is we met with Mitchell Farrell's office, Mitch and his deputy chief of staff, I believe, and they were extremely positive in providing us funding to launch a pilot program.
Providing
them considering it? They were definitely considering it, but they were sounded very excited about it. I mean, either he was really blowing smoke or it sounded like that he really thought that this was a good idea and he could make it happen. Now, you haven't gotten a confirmation back one way or the other about
it? I have not. I've heard some calls and they're going to connect with them.
We gave him a couple of different scenarios where we could do it for Joe, remind me what the numbers were. It was like $84,000 for
12 weeks.
For 12 weeks and then $175,000 for twice that amount of time. And Mitch was gravitating towards the longer period of time. He really thought it was important, which is a good indication that, you know, that he wanted to do this in earnest. So the conclusion that we arrived at, just as from a recommendation perspective, and Bill, you can elaborate further, but it would be to not not erode the daytime, early morning patrol or daytime population. The more we discussed it, the more we recollected the problems that occurred. Last time we tried to do that, the sort of the increase in, there has been an increase in crime, but, and it's primarily in the evening, but it's also been increasing during the day. So, and the majority of our stakeholders have their businesses open during regular business hours. So it was the conclusion that we came to was we want to fund this program, and I'll let Bill discuss exactly how best to do that, but not by taking it out of our daytime deployment. Does that sound right?
That sounds perfect. So, just to, if you look at this handout that you all have, talking about scheduling, you'll see the very first one shows the current schedule of deployment. And let me emphasize that this is for Hollywood Entertainment District only. This does not show the Sunset Vine deployment. The two do complement each other and assist each other, but we're looking strictly at what the Hollywood Entertainment District deployment is. And that runs, if you follow down, you can see Monday through Thursday how many people that we are deploying. Unless otherwise indicated, everything on there indicates an armed officer. The green highlight indicates unarmed officers for a total of 488 hours per week running. And this is a coverage of 6 o'clock in the morning until 8:30 at night. Now, trying to have the least impact on taking any resources away or all of the resources away for page. Steve worked along with Joe and came up with a very hard but very good suggestion here. And taking armed officers, hiring some more unarmed officers, and blending the two teams together. So if we'll see at 6 o'clock in the morning, we'll be bringing on an armed supervisor along with a mixed team, which would be, and that's highlighted in blue, an unarmed officer along with an armed officer. Later on, we will bring in some more unarmed officers. And at 12 o'clock, we would bring in another mixed team. That would run Monday through Wednesday, that particular type of deployment. Later on in the week, Thursday through Saturday, we're bringing in at 7:30 at night to 4 in the morning, only armed teams. And what it would be two armed teams, two man teams, plus an armed supervisor. This entire scenario increases our coverage hours from 488 to $600 by blending the teams together. So you're getting more visibility for it. But I will point out there may be some drawbacks, but an unarmed officer with an armed officer. Open for discussion. I know Steve and Joe may have some input if they would like to comment on that. That particular scenario, however, saves you a grand total of $135 a week. So you're increasing your hours and you're reducing your cost. The third scenario is a proposed armed schedule and deployment where we are not blending teams. We're actually adding a few more armed officers. We're moving a slight amount of deployment from during the day to be able to deploy it on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, but we are still covering the entire hours from 6 in the morning until 8:30 at night that we could be doing. And then on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, adding those two officer teams, both armed and the armed supervisor, this increases it from by 40 hours a week from 488 to 528, but it increases the cost $2,300 a week. These we thought would be good contingency plans to be able to run for a while CD13 take a look at their options. It'll give us some working time, it'll give us some testing time. Whether we want to go for a blended plan or spend a little bit more money if you have a contingency and stick with, for the most part, armed teams as we have in the past, which frankly is probably a little safer. Up to you folks. I do have to stress, because folks have said, well, what are you going to be doing? What is your mission out there, if you will? our responsibility has always been quality of life. It's been identifying problems, providing solutions whenever possible, and taking enforcement if and only if we have to. That doesn't change. That doesn't change during the day. That doesn't change at night. That allows us to take care of those particular types of things, which hopefully allows Captain Zarcone's people to be free from those types of things and to attend to more serious crimes that are going on. Hopefully, it's been a very successful formula during the day. Shouldn't be a lot of reason why it wouldn't be successful at night, but it's worthwhile taking it. Yeah, do you have anything to add to that?
The only thing that I would add is I understand completely everybody's reluctance to take stuff off the 6 in the morning shift, getting out there and trying to make it more livable for the business, the majority of businesses that open during the day. But I would just admit there are a lot of businesses that are open, and it's not just the clubs. There's a lot of businesses open late into the night. And I go back to my original argument when we first talked about this. The crime statistics show very, very clearly that in those early morning hours, when we're worried about cleaning things up, crime is at its lowest point. And that's across the whole city, but in particular in HED as well. So where we need the visibility, because what we've found out through the whole CompStat process of putting police officers where we put them, is that when you put cops on the dots, so to speak, dots being where the crimes are occurring, when you put a visible presence there, and the bid officers do count as a visible presence, they work. They're seen as somebody you don't want to commit a crime in front of. The more I can get out there visible at night, the better effect we're gonna have. Thursday, Friday, and Saturday were chosen for the pilot program because Thursday, Friday, and Saturday are by far the biggest crime days in the evening hours. So to me, it makes sense to do it. I would 100% support your decision to do that, and that's what I'm asking for.
Steve, do you have any comments?
Yeah, the last one Bill talked about has 5 officer issues. Actually, optimal would be to add 10, and I'm done with that. If you have 5 other subject, that would be safe. We could do it and not lose any muscle in the middle of it. As I did about a 4-month study, I can tell you our radio calls in the first 4 hours, 6 to 10, is about 20% of our calls. Our arrests, that's about 36%. So there is a lot, the crime stats are low, but we're doing a lot of things. Our mid 4 hours, that's our arrests are 35%, and then those last shifts are 46%. So, and the same for the hourly calls for service, those first 4 hours, 27%, the next 4 hours, 33%, the next 4, 30%, and just 10% the last couple hours, but we're busy all through the day, is what shows. And even, we look, is there a day where we can cut back? Well, we already have Sunday, the quietest day. We've already cut back there. Sort of, I believe our disclosure is pretty much optimal, which we've learned over time. But the statistics back that up. So even if we could add those 2 extra shifts, I would feel safe doing this. Optimal would be if we could just fund the whole thing.
Right.
With what we have now, but that's like 7,000 a month. But I feel we could compromise. Would really help to get those 10 extra shifts, and then we wouldn't lose our muscle in that. Otherwise, what really hurts is the 12 to 8 p.m. shift, but we can see we're actually doing a lot of stuff then too. So I don't think we can give up the morning, but I think we can add the night.
So question, just a little bit. With the number of private persons arrests that you're doing in the early morning and midday quadrant, by shifting to one arm and with an unarmed, how does that impact officer safety and the ability to handle some of these instances that, might be quite challenging? Would there be some instances that you would have to just back off and just call LAPD? What do you see in terms of change of operations?
Pretty drastic. It's untested. I was just asked to come up with scenarios. I'm not a proponent of this particular one. The armed officer's going to be in a position where you're going to have to look after this other guy. This other guy's going to have much less training. So we're game, we work for you guys. We're game to try anything. We'll do it as safely as we can. We've had defensive tactics training all day today. We're in the process of night shooting because we don't know if this is going to happen or not, but we're hitting the ground running. We're already training for it, assuming that something's going to probably happen. So They said, we're shooting now, our guys are going to the range just using a flashlight. We're gearing up for everything we can, so we'll do it as safely as we can.
And what, I just want to mention, just so the board understands the sort of the level of analysis that we've gone through with this request, that, you know, we just, as Bill said, it's a quality of life is really what we're out there trying to accomplish. And there's a lot of work that gets done on that front and a lot of positive work in that early morning shift. We're coming up against bid renewal in a couple of years.
Well, we're gonna start working on it this summer.
That's right. So one of the main things, half our budget goes to security. One of the main things people want is when they call us, we respond. Because a lot of our issues are quality of life issues, and LAPD can't get there in a timely manner just because it's not a priority issue. And then, and there's an argument to be made that they shouldn't even go there because our guys can go there and solve the problem, you know, relatively easily, and they're busy working on bigger, better things. One of the reasons why we were so cautious to pull a significant number of people off either the early morning or the middle of the day was, you know, if we get into a situation where we've got to arrest somebody and you got to take them down to PD, then you take that team off and their call volume has gone up so much over the last couple of years, and we really don't have any more people on the streets to respond to these things. So our ability to respond has been eroding just simply because we have a management district plan that calls for X amount of dollars that can only be spent through X amount of hours of deployment. Yet when the call volume goes up significantly, it's harder for us to even get there. So that's why we've been reluctant in just pulling people off either the morning or the daytime. So at the end of the day, we think we've got a couple of scenarios that the board, should they, you know, be interested can weigh in. And are you looking for a formal approval, Monica?
Well, I think that it was important to have a discussion because there's a lot of information. And maybe until we have a discussion and hear what anyone has to say, I don't really have this point on the press.
I have a quick question. Did you ever find in history, past history, even on the court for a long time, that there's a difference during the time of the year with when it becomes daylight earlier or later? Does that have any kind of an impact, number one? And number two, is a lot of the calls have to do with homeless people and getting them off the street and arrive?
In the morning.
In the morning.
Certainly. And then there's a lot of homeless calls that just come in general because there's some mental health issues or, you know, there's people running down the middle of the street. As you know, Carol Massey is explaining at the security meeting, that, you know, there's like a naked guy who jumps up on the counter in the middle of McDonald's on the service counter. I mean, you know, so there's some things going on that with drug users.
Quick example today at Denny's, a guy was going nuts in there and challenged our officer, they had a pepper spray on, but he ingested two cans of that computer keyboard cleaner stuff. And they got him with the cans and they had to take him to the hospital. But that's the kind of issues. And the calls for service are up over last year's pace was a record. Not drastically, by about 50, but still we're maintaining that pace. So that's why last year, things like arrests and business checks, high visibility patrols dropped some because we're handling radio calls and driving back and forth. And we're facing the same thing this year, not to slow down at all. It will ebb and flow this summer. We'll get more busy. We look forward to the rainy season because it usually clears the sidewalk, although we found this year earlier, it just drove everybody inside, and then they're causing all kinds of calls for service because we've got a whole lot of people huddling from the rain and causing troubles, you know, violent. It's an mental illness and substance abuse other issues, primarily.
I mean, ideally for me, we would approve the pilot program as soon as possible. And we would give the staff and the security committee and Andrews the flexibility to try different deployment schemes as outlined here to fund this project initially, with the ideal ending that CD13 provides some of their discretionary funds. We can go back to our or 100% daytime employment as it is today, and then fully fund the pilot project for a more extended period of time. Just to remind everybody, one of the benefits of doing this is we would like to have some hard data and some anecdotal evidence about the benefits of being out, having security force out at night, because when we go through a bid renewal process, there are a significant number of stakeholders that are talking about going to a more extended security, like to a nighttime patrol. So this would provide that information. Is it beneficial? Let's see how we would get, Andrew's experience. We could see how dangerous it really is out there, or whether it's a walk in the park, or, whether we're making more arrests or less arrests, or all those things.
Yeah, so John, I'm just trying to back some of the numbers in. So it looks like version 2 was proposed as a wash. Version 3 is about 2,400 a month, which is 10,000 or 116,000 a year. So, but then I heard you say,
That I consider as minimal, I can do it.
Yeah. You said for you, if you had to make the ask,
I would double that to 10 additional shifts.
10 shifts.
And then I can put both of them in that middle area. But our whole system is built on overlap. The team started 6, 10, 12, and there's always an overlap. So there's always people to back each other. But the way some of these scenarios work out, there would only be 2 officers in Hollywood, 2 in Sunset, from 12 to 8 for 8 hours.
And it's 4,500 a week.
Right.
So that would be 4,500. So then the ask or the discussion with Mitch, were they going to...
We were just talking about him funding the nighttime program, or deployment.
Which is like 85,000.
For 12 weeks. 7,000 a week. If we kept everything the same and only added 5 officers 3 days a week in that nighttime shift, $7,000, and so that's the $84,000
in 12 weeks. And Captain, we were talking with Mitch. Do you really need that those guys, the 5 nighttime guys, from 3 to 4? Because we were just wondering. It just seemed like maybe things with the running of the bowls at 2 o'clock, everybody goes out.
Yeah, no problem. Is what we have is there's a select number of businesses that are able to stay open until 4.
That's right.
And because of those, there's a concentration of people from 2 to 4.
They go over there.
They just hang.
Right.
They don't go anywhere. They just hang out. So that's when it's pretty critical to have a physical presence out there.
Okay.
Where are those dots? Like if we're to concentrate people in an area, is there a...
The 4 o'clock attractants are the Hooker Lounges, Playhouse.
But is it kind of in a concentrated area?
Somewhere, yeah.
So maybe our deployment, if it's not as large, could be concentrated in the area where, the real issue is. As opposed to trying to cover the whole...
Yeah, technically we've got to provide security for the entire district. So, practically we might spend a little bit more time there. But
you're just concentrating where the real problems are.
Yeah, but that's actually flies in the face of the whole management district plan theory.
One of the other benefits, something that could be done to kind of this whole area late at night, if there, for instance, not needed the hot spots from 3 to 4 in the morning. Throughout the whole area, what you would have noticed when you went out there is a lot of the places that are making the calls at 6 in the morning, person that's sleeping in on private property all night. They're never allowed to do that. It's not okay to sleep on a private piece of property.
Right.
They're allowed to sleep on the sidewalk or not on private property. So they could be putting trespassers in place to file a trespass letter with you. They could get them out
really
doing the same thing they would be doing at 6, but doing it at 3 in the morning instead.
Right.
That's really good point.
Captain's right, and that allows us to concentrate on what our focus is quality of life. And
right.
Attending to those things. I might add, too, if I may, on these particular scenarios, the second scenario where we're adding the 528 hours on that thing, where we're just adding arm shifts, I truly think is the safer scenario. Mixing armed and unarmed theoretically it should work, but when we have our officers out there, they're not getting into scenarios like that. They're not getting into situations like that. They're backing away from situations. If they're with an armed officer, now they're going to be placed in that type of a situation, and it's going to present some situations that we'd rather not face.
Right, and we had talked about a scenario where, let's say that Denny's situation happens and he is not going to cooperate, he's out of his mind, and so you have the two officers show up and somebody's got to try to control this guy. Well, the unarmed officers are just simply, they're not post-certified guys, they're not trained, they're not ex-police officers. So you probably don't want to have the least qualified guy go try to deal with this guy who's completely whacked out. Where on the other hand, if the most qualified guy goes in, really, if he gets himself in any kind of trouble, then the backup is not really the post-certified guy. So it's not an ideal situation.
So ideally for this, in order to make it effective, we're looking for approximately 54,000 for a 12-week program.
Is that for number three?
It's actually number three with two arms doubling up.
And it would help. I've saved $10,000 by not backfilling so far with this patient, so that will go towards this. That would be a little bit.
Okay, so that's one thing that we're discussing is what would be ideal, because you don't want to do something potentially halfway. That really doesn't make sense in the long run. We're spending money. The second one would be the timing for the counseling to get back with us. Hopefully it'll be soon, because I think Evan would like that commitment from the council office to do this also.
Certainly.
And then also, Captain, I know we had a discussion last time that in our security committee meeting that there's also an opportunity for Andrews to be deputized to issue citations that could also help us in quality of life issues. So we also have that asked of you.
On the ACE program. So I'm just a little unclear that 54 would be the 33 that would really require a CD13 infusion. Because
version 3 would be 27,000. That's only 2,300 a week.
Okay, for 12 weeks.
Yeah, 5,400 or 5,500 or 5,000 would be doubling that to the optimum.
Okay. Right.
So version 3 is about 27,000.
And CD13 would be over and above that. And that would be taking expansion the whole time, not just a public private program.
Yes.
I guess I'm still a little confused.
I would like to table this for further discussion, I think, because we're going to run out of time today, and it just seems that we need more information. I think it would be helpful. I would also like to get a little bit more information from Streetscape about the cleaning and how that impacts security as well. And I have some more questions, but I don't think that we can get this solved today.
We have 15 minutes if you want to continue, because I think.
Well, sure. I mean.
Is fairly short.
It's also a little confusing because we don't have one sheet to look at and go, here's all the figures. We just came up with another scenario. It's not that I don't want to look at the scenario. I'm interested in it. It's just I want to make sure we've got these numbers so that we're all understanding and on the same page. What time are the sidewalks cleaned?
So it starts at, our crews usually come in close to midnight, and then it just varies. They usually stay out of the club area because our guys typically get harassed. So those are usually done earlier in the morning, or I should say later in the morning. So like 6-7 in the morning in those types of areas. But our guys can usually wash anywhere from midnight to 8 in the morning, somewhere like that.
Okay. So the majority though is done earlier in the evening instead of later?
Yeah, usually like anywhere from 1 to 3. Uh-huh. It's primarily when we're washing the sidewalks, with the exception of some of those areas, like I said, that are impacted by clusters.
So I'm just, it's a curiosity point of wondering, could there be a delay on cleaning where it's actually the majority is happening at 4 in the morning or 5 in the morning going to 8? You know, it's very interesting to me that I see the heightened, what was it about the arrests, where it went from 4 and then suddenly just jumped up to 19. Right, and so I don't know what that cause is. It's just, again, it's like, okay,
a little bit more research. I think we need the assistance, absolutely. There is concern.
Is there a hybrid that we could do? Because I think Captain Zarcone's here that we can show kind of like a good fake.
Yeah.
Us moving forward to support the police department and then maybe just within, and give us 30 days to try to get a permit from the office. But take one of these steps, like possibly 23, which is only, you know, 2435, for a 4-week period, where we start testing and get it going, and then have a greater ask and have a better idea of what Mitch's office is going to do.
Well, that would be my preference.
I'd like to propose something like that.
So you're saying option three?
Option three.
Do you have to identify where that money comes from?
Four-week, how's what you're saying?
Well, I'm just saying we can just commit it for 4 weeks, so we get it going, but planning, we're going to at least do that at a minimum.
The one thing I would suggest, though, is that they've got to go out and hire people.
Yeah.
And so to hire people and train them for 4 weeks.
Well, I guess, so the question to Bill then is, are you willing to wait 30 days as we test this? Because I understand.
I think we want to mention something. This was a discussion at Security Committee last year, and then we held off, this last month, and then also prior we bring up the meeting in December. So this has been a request since last fall. So I kind of want to move it forward instead of just delaying it.
I mean, if I can answer for us, we are certainly willing to start hiring extra people, put them on, because we can always use more. We can always, very few of the guys work full time. So remove that out.
All right, so that, then the $24,000 though, extra security, comes from where?
$2,400.
A week.
A week.
So for 4 weeks, that's.
It's basically $10,000.
$10,000 a month.
$10,000 a month.
It's $9,740.
Steve, you mentioned you move something around, there might be $10,000.
Yeah, I've got about $10,000 not unspent so far, or just not backfilled and shaving shifts in anticipation that maybe you might need some.
So there's some money there. Do we have any money in our security contingency?
It's going to be tight. We have the counter maintenance, and then we approved back in October of last year of extending the fee to the cameras into the watch commander's office. So we have about $15,000.
I would suggest, even though we're looking at this $2,400 scenario, to give Ann some leeway, and especially to the supervisor on the street, that he would like to double up the shifts, even though they may try a lower amount of shifts, give them the flexibility because they may need more.
Well, I think that's a great idea. It's just a question of where that goes. Obviously, if Mitch comes through, we'll have a lot more. It's a little bit like the park and festival budget, that we're just trying to get this thing rolling, and then we can increase our deployment subject to raising the funds, either through Steve's continued effort to not backfill, like you have in the past, or whether it's Mitch with some supplemental monies, or whether we want to, take another $5,000 out off of contingency. But as Monica was saying, we're just trying to accommodate Captain Zarcone's request, which was now made, two, three months ago. And it was an urgent request at that point in time. So that's why I normally I would like to try to take as much time as possible with this. But we've looked at everything. I don't know what other new information I'm going to come up with.
I think we need to do something. I'm a little confused, forgetting which plan, forgetting the amount of money. Obviously, it's always going to come down. We conduct the experiment for 12 weeks, the pilot program, whatever it is. To the extent we learn whatever we learn, the thinking is we then would continue, or it's just by gaining that information, we would redeploy the existing money. I just throw that out there, but I think we need to do something. And I'm totally confused by what Mitch's office is thinking of doing. It's contingent on us doing something. It's
No, Mitch's office is contemplating funding the nighttime security effort that was requested.
Permanently, or just the pilot program?
Well, just the pilot program, although it would be, he was talking about going through the summertime, so that's why he was, we were talking about $12,000 a week, is that right, Joe?
$7,000.
$7,000 a week. We were talking about 12 weeks, which was $84,000. Ideally, we would do 24 weeks, and Mitch said, I think if we're gonna do this, we need to do it in earnest, which is like through a 6-month period of time. How much money does he have in a discretionary account?
I don't know what he has in his account, but he immediately jumped at doubling program and was down this.
He thought it's very important that the city
council. But doubling the program is, let's say, 12 weeks.
To 24 weeks.
Right, from starting with us, and then whenever we end, he continues,
no,
or it's just.
He would just take over. He would just take, as soon as that money came in, we would go back to doing what we do during the day, 100%, and he just pays for this.
So we could okay 12 weeks right now, and if he stepped in at the seventh week, we would have only done 6.
We could okay 4 weeks right now just to get things going.
Well,
and
my suggestion, I mean, you had a very, very good idea, but to the extent, if the original plan was going to be 12 weeks, I think we got to fund at least half. If we're going to do 6 weeks.
And then the question is, where does the money come from? So again, we've got 10,000. The thing, what's great about 4 weeks is
we have
$10,000, and this is only going to cost $96,000.
And I actually was fucking, I spent $2,000 on that today on training. That's part of it, but in my mind,
6 weeks just became 5.
And so we do have some flexibility, but I would like to get this started, and then it'll also put some pressure on Mitch, I think, to act on it.
Especially if we're able to demonstrate that it makes, you know, a real measurable difference.
Mitch is getting, every councilman, he said, is under a tremendous amount of pressure to do something about the increasing crime. And the biggest increase in aggravated assaults and robberies, and I think part one crime is what you guys call it, is in the evening. So they really, you know, this is something that's not, he's not taking some discretionary funds and partying on Hollywood Boulevard. This is something that benefits everybody in his.
I think we should move quick on it.
John, if I may, there's been a lot of discussion on the bid renewal of extended security to $24 a day, which is going to cost a tremendous amount more money. This should, between our statistics and the statistics that Captain Zarcone would provide, in a certainly a 6-month program of mission funds this, give you a good basis to decide whether or not you really want to pursue that.
And that's one of the reasons why Mitch is excited about it, is, you know, because essentially he spends the money now, but then the property owners would assess themselves enough money in 2 years to cover that for the next theoretically 10 years. So, you know, it's a little bit of seed money by LAPD that gets the BID to cover the cost of this.
Would it be reasonable to look at doing a four-week to get grease the wheel, so to speak, with Mitch and everything else, and be able to revisit it if Mitch doesn't get on board within those 4 weeks at the next meeting? I don't know time-wise if that works out.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, we have a board meeting in a month, right?
I guess there's two things. One is within the four, if we do a 4-week program, is that enough time to get data and statistics?
No.
The second one is, does that help? I mean, I know it's a little bit, but I don't even know if that's really.
Well, the only reason we would do 4 weeks is because we're confident we can extend this thing to 6 months, or, you know, 12 weeks at least.
How long would it take to get up to speed? I mean, it's not going to happen tomorrow, so.
We're trying to hit the ground running, but we need to hire some people. So I need a little more data. How many people are we going to?
Would you hypothetically say 2 weeks, a month, 6 weeks? Best guess.
A month.
A month, okay. So if we were to approve it, we'd still be talking to Mitch. The 4 weeks won't start for approximately a month, I assume. And in that time, we'll be meeting again, and, you know, we can always look to modify that and go longer if we have to, but hopefully we put some pressure on Mitch to jump in and get going.
Is there a ramp up in training time within that
when you hire people before they're fully functional, is it a week, is it a day, is it?
It's not easy to find people right now, qualified people, and that's kind of our niches. We don't just hire anybody. So I want to find some quality people. We'll mix them in, we'll have a mixture, and like we'll put experienced guys out there. And we were trained to probably train the new people in the urge. We're not going to hire people, put them straight out into the, you know, that environment. So we'll put them more in our comfort zone, and we'll put veteran guys out there and mix these guys in. It's going to be ongoing training just as we do now.
And that's my point, is 4 weeks enough to actually even extract, get up fully up to speed? You know, 4 weeks, maybe 2 weeks, right? By the time you hire and train, do people pair it up?
Try to be optimistic, because I see that people want to get started.
Don't be realistic, we don't want to compromise the same.
Yeah, I really can't say for sure, but that's minimal.
Yeah, my point is maybe 4 weeks should be 6 weeks, because it does kind of ramp up and get moving. You may already be
running. I'd take a year if you gave it to me, but I'm trying to come into work.
Quite honestly, with the Academy Awards coming on and stuff like this, it's increasingly more difficult for the officers to move around. So that gives us a few weeks to ramp up anyway. The guys that we hire, and the reason it's difficult to find guys to hire, is we want the right personalities out there and the right experience. As Steve says, they'll be interspersed with experienced vet officers, so they know what we're looking for and they know what their mission is and stuff like this. So that's really what we're
sure. And doing this scenario, it's not reallocating morning tonight, it's just hiring.
Correct.
Right. And is the primary concern of reallocating, is it stakeholder perception or is it safety for that morning time?
For the morning time, what happened last time we took away the morning shift was when everybody started to come to Hollywood in the morning, that there was still a lot of homeless sleeping, and there was, you know, it just was perceived as being less safe. It was more difficult for people to get in and out of establishments. And then the other thing that you know, it's legal to sleep in on the sidewalks until 6 a.m. Is that right? And so we come and remind them that it's no longer legal for you to be sleeping on the sidewalks. And if we don't do that, where they are turns into a compound or an expanded camp if somebody doesn't come and move them along at some point in time. So what happens is people are used to us reminding them at 6 o'clock in the morning that they now need to move on. So everybody sort of gets into a routine that way, as opposed to maybe not being asked to move on until 8 or 10, or maybe not at all if you're on one of these side back streets and nobody makes a call. So I own a building on Vista Del Mar, which is this tiny little street over there that most people have never driven on. And if there was no call for an officer that day, they wouldn't know that there's somebody's got a huge compound set up right there on the sidewalk. So it's not like we're just on Hollywood Boulevard. There's a lot of these other little side streets that need to be covered. And the early morning is a time where we can efficiently sort of go around and make sure everybody's up and we're ready for people to operate their businesses, and when that's what seems like it's a simple thing to do was removed, we just had a lot of problems that were exacerbated. People started, you know, staying longer, larger groups of people, and then, you know, what was really bad is when people would come to Hollywood at 8 a.m. and then there's just a big, it looks like Skid Row out there.
Okay, I think we all are. We're not going to change the morning, right?
I don't recommend.
Yeah. Okay, so we have a lot of discussion. Is there a motion or anything at the table? What I'm concerned about is if we carry this longer, we're going to revisit and we're going to go to the same discussion again.